Welcome to another episode of The Laugh Track. Well, there's no getting around it. January 20th is going to be a big day around here. Or as they are calling it in Russia, Nash Chovlik Beret Na Sebya Ostivenosto. It has been confusing since the election. First, Trump says there was a lot of voter fraud. Then some states do a recount, and Trump says they're wasting their time. Then we find out the Russians interfered with the election, and Trump says they did not. But then Trump says there was massive voter fraud, but has no evidence. If you focus too much on the total lack of policy knowledge Trump brings to the White House and the random tweets at 4:30 in the morning, you might think the Trump years were going to play out like the movie Being There. When you think about his petty tweets, thin skin, mood swings, and contradictions, you realize this presidency is going to be like Clueless. And Alicia Silverstone is still around to play Trump in the movie. Bad news for Alec Baldwin. But of course, the confusion started before the election. All those forecasts that said Hillary Clinton would win. Let's be clear about this. Many of the opinion polls were accurate. And if the polls missed a late break toward Trump that gave him a narrow victory in a few states, that's because there was not any polls that last week in some of those states. And the polls all have a margin of error that many forecasters ignored. All the forecasts said Trump could not win. And I'm talking about you, New York Times. Those same forecasters are still talking and trying to explain why what happened happened. My response to them is just, shut up. Stop talking. It's like when your teenager leaves the top down in the convertible and it rains and the car is ruined. I don't want to hear about it now. Just go to your room. You are so grounded. And next election, don't make any forecasts. Just report the polls. And maybe, just maybe, if we don't talk so much about forecasts, we might just have the airtime to talk about issues. Now, I don't want to go on a rant about the New York Times because they do actually report real news and do actually run investigative pieces. But during the election, they usually sold advertising space to the Clinton campaign right there above their banner on the website. Maybe not a great idea. Because it's clear it was an ad. It was not a news article. But we've just seen that America is having a tough time recognizing actual news and factual news. And besides, if you are reading the New York Times website, aren't you going to vote for Clinton anyway? Okay, I understand the financial pressures of newspapers. We need to fund reporting. And that's why the New York Times has been selling all those souvenirs it finds in its attic. But why are they so convinced New York Times readers love models of old sailing ships? Okay, I admit it. I have a Mayflower model, and it is the apple of my eye. But what evidence is there that I'm a typical New York Times reader? Just because Democrats, after the election, feel like they're going down with the Titanic does not mean they want to spend $500 on a model of the Titanic. Maybe the Times needs to hire better market analysts and stop being so predictable. The day after the election, their ads were talking about how you can find everything in Canada. You know, for a paper that cannot predict election outcomes, your ads seem to be pretty predictable. Okay, but back to Trump, or as I think of him, Tweety Pie. Trump did restart an old presidential tradition of having a New Year's reception and greeting the public. Sort of. But where presidents used to open the doors of the White House to anyone and shake hands for hours, Trump charged people $575, and he doesn't shake hands because of his germophobia. Trump did send out a New Year's Eve tweet saying Happy New Year to his many enemies who have lost so badly they do not know what to do. And then he added the word love. Shouldn't that love have to come with air quotes? Love? Can't Twitter have an app for air quotes? Or maybe a font for irony? Or maybe just an app that adds not to some words from some people, like love from Trump. Actually, I have an app for tweets from Trump. It signs every tweet the pussy grabber. So I see his New Year's tweet like that one this way automatically. The best thing about this app is that all of the tweets finally make sense. I mean, you might have seen his tweet at 4:30 in the morning trying to shame a beauty pageant winner. You would be confused. Why would anyone, let alone a presidential candidate, tweeting like this? But then you remember, oh, now it all makes sense. Now, the other thing about Trump tweets is that they have no basis in reality. Former Trump campaign manager and Twitter account nanny Kellyanne Conway tweeted that Trump's Electoral College win was historic. Actually, it is one of the smallest victory margins in history. It ranks 46th out of 58. Now, I know, Tweety Pie always feels the need to exaggerate the size of things. And maybe this is the way things go now. If you just show up, you get a trophy. Anyway, after the election, some of the people who did not vote for Trump, and that would be the majority, have been protesting and saying that Trump is not their president. Actually, he is. That's how the system works. Conservatives used to say Barack Obama was not their president, but he was. And the last time a candidate won the Electoral College but lost the popular vote, which is now just another way to say Republican president, many people said George W. Bush was not the president. But he was. That is how the system works. We have a vote, the Russians interfere, we accept the results. Now, if you're chanting that Trump is not your president, you do sound like someone who only accepts the election result if your candidate wins. Remember when Trump said he would only accept the election result if he won? Well, everyone was outraged by that comment and rightfully saw it as a threat to democracy. So you can't take that view now that if you were outraged by Trump saying the same thing. It would mean you were losing the moral high ground to Trump. And trust me, if you don't have the moral high ground over Trump, you really have to work hard to get in a position like that. His moral high ground is like a journey to the center of the earth. And just because someone pisses on you, you can't piss back on them. At that point, you're not protesting their actions. You're involved in some very weird but consensual sex with them. Very weird, but we've got to admit that if the Trump-Putin bromance goes to the next level, it's probably going to do it in some really strange, kinky ways. I've been saying someone needs to tell Trump to keep his pants on, and I know someone needs to tell Putin to keep his shirt on. Here's the point. Trump is your president. That's how the system works. You can protest him. You can call him names. You can ignore him. That's also how the system works. And you can work like hell to see that he is not reelected in 4 years. But maybe the only thing you cannot do is say he's not your president. Unless you're into that whole post-truth thing, that whole fact-free living that some of the Trumpies seem to be embracing. But let's get back to the Electoral College. I saw a link to an article by a guy named Mehta saying that Clinton did not win the popular vote. What a news scope, I thought. Every news source was reporting that Clinton won the popular vote by a few million votes. If this blogger Mehta has some facts to set us straight, that would be something. And did someone say Pulitzer? He'd get it for that. So I take the bait, click on the article. It turns out that Mehta is not saying she did not win the popular vote. Okay, what is it with you conservatives? Is writing things on the internet that are false part of what you do to get into your club? Is it like a secret handshake? And Mehta was not the only conservative pushing this line. Another blogger, Jim Treacher, also wants to ignore the numbers and say Clinton did not win the popular vote. Now, Treacher, which is not his real name, because if he wrote his real name, that would be a fact he had written on the internet, and the Republicans would disown him, and he would probably break out into a rash. And Mehta both make the same argument. They say, the popular vote is meaningless because that is not the rules of the election, they say. You never know what the popular vote would have been if campaign strategies had been different. All right, hold on right there. Trump won a small Electoral College victory despite spending less than Clinton, having much less organization on the ground, and working outside a party structure. There is a raw and strong appeal Trump has for between Trump and his voters, and that is not meaningless. It's very impressive. And it is the one thing for which I give Tweety Pie props. Well, that and the fact that he prefers to wear long pants when playing golf. I'm down with that. Actually, I'm down with any time Trump keeps his pants on and his hands on his own club. But if the conservative bloggers want to say that under different election rules, Trump would have had a much different strategy, you first have to show that he actually had a strategy. And like everything else that he tweets, there is no evidence of any strategy. Meta says that if a popular vote is what counted, we would have seen Clinton campaign in California and Trump in Texas. Well, actually, we did see Clinton in California and we did see Trump in Texas. Maybe those of us who voted for Clinton, we need to change how we talk to Trump voters. Every time you're going to say, actually, make it factually, as in, factually, Clinton won the popular vote by a few million. Those of you who voted for Gary Johnson, you just need to change the time of day you have a cuddle session with your bong. Do it after you have voted. The bloggers who argue that the popular vote would have been different under different rules are forgetting one thing. There's this thing called television. There's this thing called the internet. So when Trump or Clinton have a rally in Cleveland, they are reaching and getting the attention of more voters outside of Ohio than within Ohio. And to be fair to both candidates, if you argue the popular vote is meaningless because Trump won by only campaigning for the votes of states he needed, that isn't true. Both candidates ran national campaigns. Both made national appeals. Trump always said, make America great again, not make Cleveland great again. I know, bad example. The point is, there are some good reasons for having Electoral College. I get that. I'm not persuaded that it is the best system. Definitely not persuaded it makes sense to have it today in the way it made sense in 1788. But I do realize that both a pure popular vote and the Electoral College system we have now, they both have strengths, they both have weaknesses as a way to pick a president. But don't try to deny that the popular vote has meaning or that you won it by a significant margin. But who am I kidding? These are Trump supporters. They will deny that Clinton won the popular vote. They will deny climate change. They will deny that unemployment has cut in half under the Obama presidency. We could go on and on about all the things they will deny. They even want to deny the last 50 years of technology. Trump, it looks like now, is going to use notes written on paper and sent by courier to communicate anything that is important, which makes total sense. If you can make being president feel just like passing notes in middle school, you are in Trump's comfort zone. You have found his maturity level. No insult is too petty. No joke is too harmless that Trump will not take the bait and go after you. Are you worried that Trump will start a nuclear war when he gets that crisis phone call at 2 a.m.? Well, not if he's already deep into a Twitter war about whether his pants make him look fat, which honestly, they sort of do. But if you want to keep Trump out of trouble, you distract him. You flatter him, you insult him, you taunt him. You can spread rumors that Putin is no longer his friend. Oh, Trump will so take that bait. Yes, he is our president. And sooner or later, a country where someone without any talent can become rich and famous is probably going to be stuck with someone so unfit for office as president. But let's distract Trump for 4 years and figure out what we want to do as a country, what we want to be as a country when we grow up. Thank you for watching.